In Washington today, White House Press Secretary Robert Gibbs and Secretary of State Hillary Clinton joined critics of the conviction. The White House statement said the failure to follow the rule of law impedes Russian ties with the U.S. And for more on all this, we turn to two analysts, both Russian natives and now American citizens. Anna Vassilieva is head of the Russian Studies Program at the Monterey Institute of International Studies. Dimitri Symes is president of the Nixon Center, a foreign policy research organization. Welcome to both of you.
Good to be with you.
Anna Vassilieva, I'll start with you. What's your reaction to today's verdict?
Well, I wasn't surprised. The verdict indeed was pronounced when Vladimir Putin said to the whole world that the thief should be in prison. That was his definition of what was happening in the court, and it was very difficult to imagine any other outcome, any other verdict after what the most powerful man in Russia said.
Dimitri Symes, as I said in the introduction, Khodorkovsky would seem to be an unlikely figure for this kind of international human rights debate here. Explain for our audience a little bit how he came to be that. What does he represent?
Well, he started as a tycoon. He was a very ruthless tycoon. He took a lot of government property, paying very little, and actually using government loans, which he never repaid, to become very wealthy. He was politically very ambitious. He was not just supporting opposition parties, but he was entertaining the possibility of becoming prime minister himself, curtailing Putin's power. Having said that, once he was arrested, he proved to be a man of courage, determination, eloquence. The government was not able to break him. And when he was arrested first time in 2003, I really liked Khodorkovsky personally, and I was sorry for him. But politically, I had mixed feelings, because he was threatening the government in a very ruthless way, using the money he got illegally to mount a political challenge. What they're doing to him now is totally beyond the pale. It is not just a selective justice, it's really no justice at all.
Well, so Anna Vassilieva, what does this tell you, this case tell you about Vladimir Putin, about where power sits and rests in Russia today?
Well, what does it tell me and tells all of us is that the power belongs to someone who exercises strength, not justice, not pardon, as we were hoping until, you know, the most recent phrase that Putin announced. You know, what we see is the history repeating itself. Russian rulers are afraid to make compromises, and obviously allowing Khodorkovsky and Platon Lebedev free would be a sort of a compromise that no one can afford because they know they will lose the trust. We have to remember that the trust of the population. We have to remember that the highest ratings Putin and Medvedev enjoyed were during August 2008, during the war with Georgia. And there was no chance that they would exercise the opportunity to compromise. And that's what we're seeing now. And that, unfortunately, we may see this trend continuing.
But staying with you, you mentioned President Medvedev. What of him? Because he has spoken recently of trying to create a more of a climate for foreign investment, for economics, for a legal system. What of him in all this?
And this is all, you know, he means this, I'm sure, but he also understands that he cannot cross the path of the population's preferences. And the population still trusts Vladimir Putin more than any other politician. This is the data from Levada Center poll of this December, the late December. So Putin is the most trusted politician. Putin is extremely popular, 79% of popularity. And there was, again, no way the president of the country would try to change that or try to cross Putin's path.
Dimitri Symes, the statements from the U.S. officials today were quite strong, actually, in terms of, well, the Secretary Clinton said the case, quote, raises serious questions about selective prosecution and has a negative impact on improving Russia's investment climate. What does that say to you? I mean,
I think that these statements were, as you said, strong but measured. Mm-hmm. And there is no question that there is a capital outflow from Russia. Foreign investors are leaving Russia. Medvedev's promises notwithstanding. And when investors look at what is happening to Khodorkovsky, they would ask themselves, why would they put their money in a country like Russia? Why not in Brazil? Why not in China? whether the administration likes it or not, what is happening to Khodorkovsky has implications for the U.S.-Russian relationship. Let me make one point about Medvedev. I think it is clear that Putin is the paramount leader, and the way Khodorkovsky is treated to a large extent is because of Putin. Having said that, Medvedev wants to run in 2012.
For a second term.
For a second term. And the last thing he would want to happen, in my view, is to see Mr. Khodorkovsky out of prison as a victim, as a hero, as a courageous man of means who could challenge Mr. Medvedev. So Medvedev wants to show more leniency to Khodorkovsky, but he does not want, in my view, to see Khodorkovsky out of jail before next presidential elections.
Well, Anna Vassilieva, coming back to you, especially on the U.S. statements, and would statements, what strikes you about them, and would statements like that provoke a backlash from Russia?
No, there will be no backlash because everyone in Russia knows that there is a selective justice. Everyone in Russia knows that this is a politically driven accusation and verdict. But at the same time, when Russia ever had a fair judicial system, you know, anyone who read Resurrection by Lev Tolstoy written in the 19th century, early 20th century, knows about that, about the complete lack of justice. Anyone who read Varlam Shalamov's Kalima stories or Archipelag Gulag knows that the 20th century never brought fairness and justice to Russian people. And, you know, in the chaos in the 90s, no one bothered to be building or rebuilding the justice system. So why did we decide all of a sudden that overnight Russia or Russian people will enjoy and, in fact, will know, will have a taste of what it means to live in the country where the system of justice is fair and it is being exercised? They don't know what it is. All they know is there is a strong popular leader who found the right discourse of communication with the people, and there is the oligarch who does not carry much respect or pity among the people. 2% of the Russian population were closely watching the court hearings. 2% of the population.
Well, Dimitri Symes, we've heard the verdict here. We have not heard the sentence yet. Is there still some possibility of some kind of compromise or some potential leniency?
I think so. I think that if they give Khodorkovsky 14 years, as prosecutors have asked, that would be a personal humiliation for Medvedev.
For the president.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. After what he said about justice, about justice not being selective, I think if some leniency is not shown to Khodorkovsky, Medvedev would really be politically diminished in Russia. And I agree that not many people in Russia are watching the trial, but the political elite, the influential people, are watching the trial very carefully. And if Khodorkovsky gets what the government have asked in terms of sentence, a lot of people would say, well, Medvedev is a nice boy, he talks big, but he is not for real.
All right, Dimitri Symes and Anna Vassilieva, thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us.